All right.
You're recording too?
I'm too.
Yep.
Okay, well, here we go. Let's do this.
There's the moderator.
There you go. Idiot.
She was waiting for you.
Okay, you're the professional. Okay, well, this is the first edition of Punkonomics actually being videotaped. And actually, it's the first time we've gotten together since we stopped recording at the studio.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah, it's since we kind of got banded in many ways.
Yeah, working on our day jobs, you know.
Yeah, so anyways, a lot of things going on. Venezuela, Ukraine, among other stuff, but the most important topics right now is all the stuff going on in the Ukraine and Venezuela.
But before we start, just see right behind you, I believe, on the side table.
Side table, yeah. And also for the whoever's surfing on the internet and just caught onto it, this is Dr. Benny Balick.
Cheers.
Professor in economics, currently at Rollins College, is tenured professor. I'm a former alumni and also a world traveler, a former flight attendant. And for those of you who hate airlines, see, I'm a glorified waiter.
that's our show, though, you know, that we've been doing the blog posts and the podcast in the past, and here we are coming back. But yeah, I mean, I am a working professor, but this is our show, private. The views and opinions don't represent anybody, etc., etc., blah,
right.
blah, blah. Yeah.
At least in not any institution that we know of or affiliated with. It's all us, so.
There's still academic freedom, just about, so let's be thankful for that while the going's good. So yeah, let's jump right in. I'm going to basically go off of a blog post I did. I tried to finish a couple of papers that are past due deadline and to say something to intervene in the conversation on Venezuela and Ukraine that's raging. And I think it's important that we clarify. There's a lot of misconceptions. So I'm going to kind of launch off of that a little bit. There's already updates. We'll see how they come along. We'll experiment. And it's going to be raw, basically. We don't really intend to even edit this, right? So there you are. So here it is. I mean, the title that came up with was We Are Still Being Played, Venezuela and Ukraine in Context. And the subtitle, with the help of a former student, who's really cool, Greg, The Post-Occupy, Post-Arab Spring, Co-opting of Media and Social Media for the Ends of Destroying Democracy and Promoting the Interests of the Upper Class or the 1%.
Right.
Now there's a nasty, very dark caricature, but you'll have to go to punkonomics.org to check that out. So let me read and you stop me, eh? Where does one even start to answer the question everybody's asking? WTF is going on in Venezuela and Ukraine? So in the spirit of punk and French postmodernism, I'll just stick a bunch of things together. It's called bricolage. I provide a number of good, serious sources at the bottom of this blog, and I will remind you later, and we'll obviously, wherever you post this, YouTube, etc., we will have that stuff available to you if you want to dig a little deeper and see where we're coming from with this. Okay? So, the question is, right, is it a bunch of democracy-loving students engaged in non-violent resistance being violently oppressed by totalitarian governments? The short answer, no, it is not. But it's hard to see the big picture without getting into the long history of Venezuela and the Ukraine and many other places. Hell, you need to look at the past 500 plus years to really get the picture. And I wanted to say, you know, that this is why you need education. Yeah, that's what's good for. The problem is it's very difficult to get a good real world education. In fact, even the best institution, you still have to keep reading and being curious.
So can you tell us what's going on in the past 500 years?
Yes. Well, I mean, you know, you're looking at colonialism, you know, I mean, where do you start? You know, everybody's complaining. Some of these people that these protests are against, most notably the most famous recently deceased Hugo Chavez, Nicolas Maduro, who followed him, is the brunt of the attack. And the other, you know, somewhat socialistic, somewhat left-wing leaders of Latin America are the first Indian faces to be seen in power in Latin America since the Spanish conquest.
Right.
No, the Portuguese conquest.
And a lot of that has to do, because of the general perception here in the States, to only learn American history. And the view here is that South America hasn't been doing anything. They're still living like savages. Versus you and I know they have been going through a lot of struggle, a lot of changes.
Sewing our shirts, picking our vegetables.
Right.
So at the very least that, right? This long, prolonged history on which, when you look at it that way, the argument that is really an important aspect here is that these guys, not perfect, and that's probably the topic for another show to go a little bit more into the economics of what's going on in Venezuela, because it's all like, oh, there's shortages, there's inflation. Yeah, it's true, there is. But hunger is still going down, even this year with the inflation and everything, every year. In fact, it's the only country in Latin America that there's nobody really hungry anymore. We compare it to other countries that are supposed to be friendly, free market, allies of the United States and Europe. Over there, more people die a day at the hands of the police than ever in the history of the Chavista regime. So, we're already kind of going on emotional tangents here, and hell, you are what you is, as the great Frank Zappa used to say.
Yeah, but that's pretty curious that the economic effect hasn't really changed the criminals in Venezuela, because it's actually gone down, even though there is a current inflation. It is going up in inflation, which here in the States, when inflation goes up, crime goes up as well.
Well, the inflation there is a major problem. And I'm almost like, okay, hold on to that a little bit, because really it's kind of, you need a longer story. And I can already provide a couple of links to bigger experts than me about this. I mean, I know economics, but I'm not a specialist on Venezuelan economics, that's for sure. But I can maybe do some interpretation thereof. But anyway, so this is the big picture. Actually, the pretty famous, very famous Noam Chomsky points out to this a lot, that when you go and talk in the media about current events, one of the main problems, apart from ideologies and interest groups and all that, and conspiracies, etc., is just that to really understand what's going on, in all but the most irrelevant things, you gotta do your homework, you gotta do the background. You cannot tell it in 5 minutes. It just doesn't work. You have to go into the background a little bit to understand, because you always see it from a vacuum, and then it has a picture. But the picture is more complicated than that.
So a
little bit, like on personal level, I've had having arguments with people, ex-students, I work in a rich college, so the Venezuelans I know generally come from the upper crust, the very, very upper crust, or the middle crust. There's one exception. Hey, Yossi. But overwhelmingly, to be able, the vast majority of the people of Venezuela, the notion of going to a private school, to go, not even in America, over there, we're already talking about the top 10%, maybe not only the top 1%, or the leaders of the student revolution now, which are not in the top 1%, in the top 0.001%, millionaires in US dollars. Those are the people behind the current uprising, and that's a bit of a problem. And also the vast majority of the students we see in the streets rioting in the rich neighborhoods. This is not happening in downtown LA of Caracas.
Right.
This is happening in Beverly Hills, overwhelmingly. No, entirely, actually. So that needs to be pointed out clearly. These are countries that are very poor. So we're not talking about just not being rich. If you're a shop owner in Caracas, you're already, in the top 10% probably of the country. Though again, the bottom 90% have seen their standard of living unequivocally and unarguably rise dramatically since the change of regime when Chavez came to power democratically in 1998. But it's difficult. I'm honestly trying to engage here. I'm honestly trying to avoid the throwing of insults as best I can. And it's difficult for me because I have a lousy personality. I'm abrasive, big mouth, opinionated.
Well, just being blunt, it tends to put people on the edge. But let's be realistic. A lot of people don't understand or even know what transpired in Venezuela under Chavez.
Yeah.
Pretty much the U.S. Media presented Chavez as the Antichrist.
That's the context here. People heard Chavez is like along with Saddam Hussein and Osama bin Laden.
Right. So now the perception is, oh, okay, well, let's help out this Lopez guy, who actually is really a plant for U.S. diplomacy.
I haven't even posted it on the blog yet. It's ready in the draft, Wikipedia just leaked all the memos, He's been on the pay and coordinating with the CIA since already 2002. our good friend Leopoldo Lopez. His family has been in parts of the juntas running that country over the years. He's part of the old, old money. I think you could say that he's a little bit like a George W. Bush, but without the charm, the charisma, and the style of George. So I'm comparing Lopez very unfavorably with George W. Bush, but in terms of demographic, kind of a similar kind of guy. And apparently he's pulling the hood off a lot of Venezuelans. Oh, I'm a popular guy and stuff. Just like George W. Bush has produced the miracle of kind of trying to come through as a cowboy.
Except he probably is probably a little bit more honest. He probably doesn't drink beer, but he probably does drink wine.
Only the best, I'm
right,
sure.
Exactly.
Okay, listen, you know, I mean, I was just saying that I'm trying to avoid being an asshole. So let's try here a little harder. Okay, listen, first of all, let's put Ukraine aside a little, because while there are clearly parallels, you know, let's try and stay at least make a heroic attempt at being somewhat focused on something. And I know a little bit more about Venezuela, but we'll see where we go with this, all right? And I have linked already a couple of quick videos about Ukraine, just poking some holes into the standard narrative of what's going on there. All right, you know, so let's, there are problems in Venezuela, you know. First of all, they have to be put into context because they're accomplishing some remarkable positive changes. I'm trying to distinguish in the real problems to some extent and the fabricated problems, the propaganda, or the problems that, you know, for some people, you know, this isn't good. Just like for the proverbial 1% in America, the crisis of 2008, you know, that still leaves a quarter of Americans out of work, 20% of Americans' children hungry, and there's no end in sight, was splendid if you were fortunate enough to be at the very top of the wealth and income distribution. You got richer since then, you know? The more people lose their homes, the more profit you actually make because you hold stocks in the bank, etc., etc. So you always have to see for who. Now, in the long, successful overall history of capitalism, let's accept that for a moment, capitalists have always tried to keep a balance. You know, famously Henry Ford, not a socialist, in fact, a Nazi, right? Sympathizer and financier of Adolf Hitler, but that's another matter. He was smart in the sense of, I'll pay my workers a little more so that they can afford goods and services, so that they're loyal, stable, and productive. So I'm trying to say that capitalism has attempted to find that balance when it succeeded over the years. And that balance has been shot for the past 35 or 40 years. And that's really the source of major problems. And over there, in the poor world, in Venezuela, they try to make a difference. And they're the only place in the world, Venezuela and the country that it enabled in many ways, that it helped through oil money, through political support, to make these reforms. And these are all not liked by the mainstream media because they are so-called socialists. Right. Well, they're market socialists, certainly, if socialist at all. That's the only place in the world where things have gotten better over the past 10 years. The only place on earth. People might probably be thinking right now, China. No, again, for the bottom 90%, I'm willing to start 90 for sure, probably more, percent of Chinese, things have gotten worse in the past 10 years. You know, hey, it got good in the 90s a little bit, but worse in the past 10 years.
What's,
you
know, market socialism? What is that?
Well, it's, you know, it's progressive liberals in America, in some sense, where you do correct for the injustices, you actively promote opportunity, because opportunity is not equal, unless you live in La La Land.
So it's like France?
But you maintain the market system.
Sweden?
It's a balance. Different countries find their balance different. So those, I would say, are actually on the right wing of that. I know a lot of Americans think that, you know, European, they're a little bit on the right. They need to be more socialistic because they have 90% of the population living in third world poverty. France doesn't.
But tell me something. Don't you think that the advancement that the Chinese supposedly have done, it's not really been done by the poor people. It's been by the people who either are in government or had enough money to start businesses, which the government will help.
Overall, yeah.
Right, because the peasant in China has a different story.
There was progress in the 90s, you know, where people went to work for new export industries and got better work. And even today, some of those people, even in somewhat sweatshops, are doing not that bad. But, you know, you're talking about a sector of the population, you know, 200 million people, that's a lot of people.
right,
who live in a vibrant capitalist economy. In the past 10 years, even that is coming under significant pressure, just like in the West, you know?
But even on the contrast...
What about the other billion?
You know, even on the contrast, for as much as progress they claim, they got cities that are completely empty. You know, they're huge ghost towns. Yeah. So, if you were going to evaluate the economy, I don't know, I don't think they've been doing that great.
No, absolutely.
To me, it's more kind of like window dressing. It's kind of big facade. You know, we are China, we're a big country. We're taking care of business, just like we do here in the U.S., pretty much, you know, a smokescreen.
Yeah, you have to be careful. I mean, you know, again, I mean, this is a whole other topic, right? And we should get to it too. There's a lot of success in China. In fact, some of the interesting, I got a colleague, Zhao Chang, who argues rather effectively how a lot of the good things that happened in China, like in the 80s and 90s, were already started by the communists. So the momentum was already there, even under Mao, in some ways.
Right.
What I think we can all agree, or anybody again, is that the last 10, maybe a little bit more, I say 10, you know, round number, yeah, years, the Chinese economy has significantly retreated. It's the 1% there. Now there are millions of people in the 1% there, right? I mean, again, there's only, and the bottom 90%, right, the billion, are really suffering. And there's a lot of uprisings there that we don't cover. You know, people a lot.
Right, like the Uyghurs. Oof. The Uyghurs have been uprooted
for a long
time. That's
somewhat ethnical, maybe. Right. But there's also, no, everywhere, like in these cities, that they lose their conditions, their standard of living goes down, there's no clinics anymore, things are falling apart while they see the bosses driving in Italian Ferraris. Right? So again, they're suffering from the same. They can't sustain. The capitalism lost its ability to sustain that balance where the rich get richer, the poor maybe stay poor,
right.
But the middle class is getting a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I mean, you got to maintain at least that for capitalism to work. Yeah.
So Ukraine, what exactly is going on?
Look at Ukraine. I'm
dying to get to that one because
I don't know. I mean, we're
very perplexed and just trying to get my
head around. It's trickier even, but you know, we talk about Venezuela. Let's go ahead. Here's a line that really moved me from this excellent, by the way, documentary, which I think people should watch on Netflix or elsewhere. That's where I got it. The Square, right? It's really, really cool. Check it out. It's about the Tahrir Square, you know, the Egyptian revolution, right? That failed and failed and failed again, you know. I watched it explicitly to say something, to try and open my mind to the feeling of looking at these, you know, students in the streets getting shot at by police, which we were inundated in Venezuela and the Ukraine, and I know that that's not really what's going on, but I wanted to get in touch with that feeling, you know, because I'm so concerned with this postmodern twist that's in my blog post in some detail, that now the well-meaning people that want freedom and democracy are in fact becoming kind of, we are being co-opted by the very power structure that oppresses us. So we're cheering on these kids in the streets, but we're actually cheering on an orchestrated scenario. And that's such, the depth of cynicism disturbs me. And again, my attempt to reach to the kids that I try not to harass, despite my bad personality, but telling them that this is not what's going on here. So there's a wonderful line there where an old man says, again, more detailed in the text, the rich don't need freedom, the rich are already free. And that is kind of a case for what's going on. In Egypt, it was a dictatorship, a real nasty dictatorship, which supported by,
right, of course,
us as usual. and they honestly, students of all walks of life, rich secularists, poor Muslims, poor working class, joined together. Overwhelmingly representing the country of Egypt, that joined in the square and took power and got Mubarak to fail. But the army was already conniving behind, along with the Muslim Brotherhood. A lot of Muslim Brotherhood were perfectly good, decent, honest people sitting together with the secular kids in the square. But their leadership betrayed them and the country and everybody, together with the army, with the support of the United States State Department. And they created the Muslim Brotherhood government. It was almost designed to fail to allow the excuse then of the government to take over control. And the revolution
army.
For now, the army. And the revolution for now is finished. You know, people are hiding because they are being arrested and persecuted for real. So you see that and you go, you see the same similar images in Venezuela and Ukraine, and you go like, yeah, you root for them, of course you do.
Right.
Sadly, again, who are in the streets? You know, these are overwhelmingly representative of, and demographically in the case of Venezuela more than Ukraine, rich kids rioting in their rich neighborhoods,
right,
around their private expensive schools. Yeah, the majority of Venezuelan people are still behind their government. And let us give a little, you know what, kudos, right, to the opposite. I disagree with him, Enrico Capriglio, who is a right winger, who is against the Chavismos, who wants to bring it back to a kind of neoliberal system that would fail the people, yeah? And he lost the elections last time we had George Cicerello Mayer in our show. So it was in the summer, and that was in the spring. He lost the elections to Maduro, who replaced Chavez after he died. By not a lot, he did a good showing because people were kind of concerned with the problems of the Venezuelan economy, no doubt. And but then, now he speaks against the crazy, especially most famous Leopoldo López, right-wing billionaires who are running this this rich kid uprising.
I'm kind of curious, is there any information showing that Maduro is changing what Chavez started?
No, not really. He isn't. But you know, that reminds me of what George's book on We Created Chavez teaches us, that in many ways we think Chavez and his people were pushing Venezuela to the left. But if anything, they were moderating, slowing down the push to the left, because you have a part of the democracy there. It's not just the presidential elections. Americans should be very cynical about the importance of presidential elections, and political scientists know that. So the real democracy in Venezuela, and why it is one of the most vibrant democracies on earth, are these neighborhood groups, teachers groups, workers groups, feminist groups, transgender groups, each with political recognition and power, checking on each other. So you have a lot of this diffused local government going on. And many of them are much more radical than Chavez or the Chavista government ever was.
Right.
So in many ways, they are pushing to the left hard. And that hits that wall that is a problem in the world that we cannot get around. It's simple, really. When you have mass poverty in the world, especially when the mass poverty is no longer slowly but surely getting better, as it did in the post-World War II era, for many, you know, getting better. For many not, don't get me wrong, but for many getting better, certainly in the richer parts of the world. When you have this mass poverty everywhere, and you have democracy of some kind, what kind of government do you get? A left-wing government.
Right.
Call it left, right, call it frank. What you are asked is to share the wealth. So that's pretty hardcore left. In many ways, the Latin American socialist government, they're legitimate, the big, you know, the elected ones, not the guys in the barrio, you know,
right,
who give them hell. As they should, are stopping that, saying, whoa, 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 we can't go that fast. We are market socialists, after all. We have a long-term commitment to bringing justice and opportunity. We'll open clinics, we'll allow you into schools, we'll give you opportunity to advance yourselves, but we cannot go all Marxist on you overnight, because we can't confiscate the wealth of the rich. In fact, that's where the inflation in Venezuela more rarely comes from. The fact that the minute you shake things around, the rich are, you know, taking care of business.
Right.
And why would they, in a sense, you know? It's hard to say, to tell somebody who's rich, no, you're going to sacrifice half your wealth for the benefit of your fellow man. I mean, that's a pretty tall order. There are some who do it, but they're very few and far between, you know? So they're speculating, they're moving their wealth outside, or whatever it is. So you have that tension going on in Latin America, and especially in these countries that are seeing reform, where the people like Chavez and Morales and others are actually slowing down the call for reform. But I want to roll back again. Since World War II, since before, you got a chronic problem. If the powerful rich nations of the world allow democracy, as they claim to do, if you read our history, you find out that no, we don't. We actually crush it, mostly. That's what we do. That's our foreign policy. But hey, you know, you can't have it both ways,
right?
Are you willing to accept democracy in the world? in that case, even in America, if we had real democracy, they would be, the vast majority of Americans want redistribution. They're tired of the billionaires paying little taxes. I mean, this rhetoric of the Tea Party types that are all over the media, and even the president talks like that, and he's supposed to be a progressive, you know, I mean, all that, that's the people know better.
You know, and that's where it gets all confusing, because democracy is actually tailored. It's not the democracy in the sense that you can do whatever you want. I mean, I had a...
compromise.
Yeah.
No, endless compromise.
And the perception is, I mean, most people here in America, they go, oh, like, democracy, freedom, and all that kind of stuff. I had a argument with a friend of mine who was with the military stationed in Korea. And when he came back, we got into politics, and we were arguing back and forth, and he said, well, you know, well, we're there fighting for freedom, you know, and I'm like, okay, so what freedom are you talking about? Freedom of speech, because you can't really go down the street and say, well, the president is this, 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 and that, because eventually somebody's going to come around and arrest you, and until you scream, you know, for your rights, you're basically arrested. So there is no such thing as democracy as the way we see it. It's tailored. And in some of these countries, you know, they modify in a way where, yeah, the extreme rich and then the very poor are the ones that are kind of dealing with, and the ones in the middle are non-existent, like what's happening today. The middle class is pretty much almost dead here. So in these countries like Venezuela...
That's why the economy, American capitalism is dying,
exactly.
Because the middle class doesn't buy stuff.
Exactly. When you see the Venezuelan model with the Chavez, you know, they try to stomp it down because they know exactly what's going on. They're trying to teach people that democracy is tailored. You know, and one thing that I found really curious, and I was listening to NPR on the way over here, was that right now the left is the Lopez people. The way they're going about it and their propaganda is they're hitting the rich academia. Because when you think about it, and when you look at the media here in the States, who do we usually follow? Academia. You know, and that's common sense around the world. So,
well, you know, celebrities.
Right, or celebrities. And by the way, you know, I got to hit on one of the celebrities while we're on this.
We can't share?
No, Cooney. George, I saw your whole speech about the Ukraine and all that, but... You know, just like most of us, we really don't know what's going on there.
Listen, we'll go there. We'll go there. I mean, this, of course, I mean,
I wanted to throw that.
I'm not a betting man, but of course, the order degenerated. If I feel obliged, I'll fill myself at night in the toilet reading my blog and put that up there too. So let's just go.
But it's interesting how Venezuela is using academia
and
the rich academia, not the ones in the public schools.
No, not so much. Right. And you know, and you do have celebrities talking. And I mean, but it is a twist. I mean, I gotta give them that. It's really hard if you're not really following this stuff very carefully and reading, you know, a lot of it's hard to not be duped. I mean, I'm not being here, oh, you're stupid, you got duped. There's all that, you know, as many of my students know, that really pisses me off. This whole cottage industry, it's part of the problem. Oh, Americans are just ignorant, they're stupid, you know. No, they're not. They're suffering under the most effective propaganda machine the world has ever known by a different league, you know. Not that it's better than the Soviets ever had. I mean, Soviet people, they couldn't sell their product, you know. So people knew the government was lying to them. Well, here, not so much, but increasingly so. The problem is then, who do you listen to, you know? That's not obvious. Where do you get your... A lot of that, when I was negating a lot of things people posting, I kept people telling, where do you get this info?
Right.
So I share the... But why would you believe this guy from that university and not believe this guy from another university? My only answer is because I've been following Venezuela since 98. Because I've been, you know, because I'm 47 and this is my job. So I had the luxury of reading history for a living.
Right.
And, so it's easier, not obvious, unless you're a history buff or, you know, but of course
and then
we
when
must.
You do get it, you know, it depends on where you're getting that source, because here in school...
True that, and you know, open up half the history of the world is, let me say it, was white supremacist, you know, when you read it. You go to the library of your local library and pick up the world expert on the Middle East to understand what the hell is going on there. You know, you've got to pick up who? Bernard Lewis, you know? White supremacy is the most polite way I can call it. But, you know, you touched on a couple of things. South Korea, that's worthwhile. South Korea, yeah. We know about North Korea. Just recently condemned, you know, horrible. But South Korea, one of the most rich developed countries in the world. But you are right. I remember, you're old enough to, I remember watching on TV every after the students in South Korea.
Right.
Real students, by the way. Yeah. Again, you know, I mean, a broad section of the population, popular section of the population. Every day after class, they put on those bicycle helmets and baseball bats and go fight with the police.
Go for it. Yeah.
Throughout, I mean, my youth, you know, I saw that. So they were a client state of the United States, but internally, their people forced a different model. The United States accepted that model. It's still a highly capitalist country. But it's rich and it has a middle class. It's suffering from the same problems that we all are suffering, the pressures against the middle class, the maldistribution of income, etc. But still, I'm saying they fought for it. They fought not to become some kind of client third world state like Colombia, you know, our friend, as opposed to Venezuela, our enemy. Yeah. Just I like to point out another thing that we discussed, because I blogged it too, that we have 10 registered deaths in the Venezuela uprising. Yeah. Listen, maybe there's more, right? 10 registered. Half of which, by the way, are on the side of the police and the pro-Chavista, right? It's 10, you know, don't get me wrong, right? 10 lives, maybe 20. But every day in Colombia, more like labor organizing, strikers, indigenous farmers get killed, you know, every day of the year, you know, or in the entire upheavals of what's going on in Venezuela. You know, you get pictures on Facebook of Caracas burning. Well, you know, not really.
Right.
Sure, it's scary. Don't get me, you know, yeah. But
and the propaganda is smart. I mean, I know that several mediums are pretty much exposing the false information that's being put out there, particularly like we were talking about earlier.
Increasingly, it seems to be.
About the porn site being used, you know, and all that. But at the same time, that serves a purpose because, just like you said earlier, I mean, you hear all this different information, and then where do you go to, you know, for the right information?
Yeah.
And I think after a while, that tends to set into people, and they burn out, and they go like, okay, we'll go with what the majority wants, or what my neighbor is talking about.
Yeah.
Needless to say is that everybody has their own needs and issues, so there you go.
We go actually with what fits best into our personal narrative.
Right.
And this is where, you know, you can, and how do you know? I mean, because you see the mechanisms. That's what, you know, me and my wife behind the camera, you know, we spent all these years, you know, in libraries, you know, for a middle-class lifestyle, you know, and all that. So, you know, where does it come in? Yeah, you read that stuff. I mean, you know, it's Frankfurt School. This is spectacle, you know, Société du Spectacle. It's not reality. What reality? That's so 20th century. You know, it's like, what story fits in with the other stories that I've heard in my youth, you know? That's what sells, right? And hence that mechanism of, they're brave students against the power. So we create that narrative. It's a real narrative. Sometimes that's exactly what's going on. But then you can engineer a coup by billionaires and co-opt not only the people but even people in the place itself that might be weaving their own narrative, not realizing who they're really fighting for, or maybe they know who they're fighting against, but they might not be aware of who's behind the scenes, you know, and it's not Illuminati or anything, it's just, you know, powerful people who like power.
And it's a very effective strategy, because if you think about it, it creates a schema for people to just go like, okay, well, that's what's happened, this is what we need to do. And what they don't understand is that they're just given a a script to follow with very few facts, and psychologically, I mean, basically you're being indoctrinated, you know, in many ways.
Here it is, the script. That's maybe the one thing where I try to put it in there. And this comes from somebody who was a political scientist, philosopher, Gene Sharp, and I want to defend him right away, you know, because some of the radical community over the past years have been accusing that his book is being found often in the CIA, you know, libraries primarily.
Right,
but
I
honestly think he's well-meaning, you know, completely well-meaning. He's trying to figure out how to take over power in an effective way. In some ways, Chavez took power, and I think for the better in Venezuela.
Right.
Nobody's perfect, but overall for the better. through an electoral process. He tried, like 10 years before that, to take it with a traditional coup, with the military taking over the country, for the same reason, you know, for well-meaning, I think, you know. And he failed, and he went to jail. And after that, there were people who still tried to struggle, and there was the massacre by the government, led by the freedom fighters' parents, yeah, etc. But here it is. I mean, and I like to just people think, I mean, here's what's happened in Venezuela and in Ukraine. This is the script. This is the theory behind it. Of course, it gets tweaked, right? So first you go, you do softening. Right? It's how to overthrow a government by non-violent methods. Noble cause.
Right.
But of course, understand, the non-violent here, what we're talking about is not guerrillas, not foreign invasion, not military coup, right? But somehow without that, an organized army of some kind. First, you do softening, yeah? So you create a climate of opinion focused on deficiencies, yeah? Ooh, the economy in Venezuela is terrible, right? It's got its problem, but it's better than it was before, that's for sure. And it's not that terrible. Aside, we gotta say that one. When you had that blogger vehemently yelling, you know, yelling in writing, how there's terrible shortages in Venezuela right now, and for the past year and a half, it's unacceptable. I was going to bake a cake today, and there was not enough powdered sugar, or what did I don't even remember what it was. Milk was it? I think it was milk. Sorry,
yeah, I'm sure they're short of caviar
was,
too.
Yeah, they were probably short of caviar too. Right, you just hop on your plane and go to Miami, baby. They have plenty there. But you know, I heard that, I was tearing my hair out. Oh, like, we've heard that one before. Oh, I can't bake cakes, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
you
exactly.
know that. So I'm sorry, I'm not scandalized. Again, mass hunger is down, yes? So you can't, we should fix that, don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, what do the kids call it nowadays? The latest, first world problems, right? 1% problems, or maybe it's a 10% problem, quite frankly. Okay, so right, softening. You cause a public opinion focusing on deficiencies, disseminate discontent, yeah, promote shortages, criminality, internal fractures, sabotage, and yes, a lot of the problems in the economy in Venezuela is not just, oh, Maduro can't run the country, oh, Chavez can't run the country, oh, there's corruption. Yeah, nobody's perfect.
Right.
Hello, you know. But there are like actively, you know, hoarding by the wealthy, taking that milk and selling it, you know, because of the foreign currency and the black market, going selling it in Colombia to convert it to dollars and sending it to your bank account in Miami. There's a lot of stuff going on. The energy sector was indeed, before it got nationalized, you know, cutting down on power to make the government look bad. Hey, are you watching House of Cards? When I was watching that in House of Cards, I was like, oh yeah, that's what's happening in Venezuela. I don't know if it's happening in America, maybe too. Yeah. Then you have stage two, delegitimization. Delegitimization. Yeah, I did it right. Ethical and political fracture, right? The separation and stuff. Media campaigns accusing government of being totalitarian and or communist. And contrasting opposition as the opposition to the government, right, as fighting for freedom and human rights. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's, by the way, another place where the cracks are showing. In Ukraine, you know, we're seeing the neo-Nazi insanity that is part of the freedom fighters. It's significant.
Right.
Not all, not even a majority, but a significant minority. In Venezuela, by the way, less known so far, and I'll get to promoting that later, there's a tremendous amount of that. Those, you know, some of the students, of course, most of them aren't, but some of them are, you know, talking about these brown-skinned
indigenous
colonists.
Right.
Bastards that run the country, unlike back in the good old days when we were all lily white.
Right, exactly.
You know? So, yeah, you know, do you see that? I mean, the brown-skinned majority of Venezuela sees it, that's for sure.
Well,
you know?
Sure.
That's why somebody like Lopez cannot be elected.
Right.
You know? Not even a player, a contender. Because, you know, there's no way in hell he can get elected. So, and that's maybe why, really, in some sense, this was all a fracture of the opposition. You know, they want the play. They don't want the moderate opposition. They want the radical opposition because they know that they have no chance to elections ever. Then you have the street heating. That's the latest part. This we've had for years. Then you have the street heating. Promote conflict and street mobilization. Promote struggle for globalized political and social demands. create state reaction and consequently public discontent in order to radicalize the confrontation. Try and get the police to get violent on you. And of course, it needs to be probably stated, right? I mean, you know, what happens in America when people, you know, imagine somebody, come on, every country, you know, defend itself against trying to unseat an elected government by means of violence. I'm not sure I like it, you know. I'm on the anarchist side usually, you know. I'm torn.
Right, right.
But this isn't it.
For Venezuela, on that step, you know, it's basically a few rich neighborhoods where they're blocking off the streets and causing all these traffic jams and making it look like this, you know, huge amount of protests, and it's not.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in that sense, that's not working.
And in terms of violence, I mean, let me put it mildly, you know, at least as much of the violence is instigated by the opposition than by the Chavista government. And I know this one, this statement right here is going to cause some people I love dearly to give me shit, but... But the evidence seems to suggest it's hard to know exactly.
Right. And don't be afraid to send hate mail. We love it.
Yeah. The evidence seems to suggest that certainly... And this shows you the script they're following. It's in the plan to try and force them to tell them, no, go for it. It's like, no, maybe we shouldn't hang as they did last night, the night before last, hang a barbed wire, Mr. General. I'm not just using the word, right?
Right?
Mr. General, maybe we shouldn't hang barbed wire at the height of heads so that the police on motorcycle will get beheaded as two did. Maybe that's kind of not cool. Maybe we're kind of, then they might maybe, and maybe they will come and take revenge afterwards. You know what?
Sure, I mean,
Heat it up, right? Make the violence. If you want the state to expose itself as authoritarian, even if it's democratic, even if it's trying to be reasonable by as much as a state can be reasonable, you want them to get crazy as you can. Then you have the reaction, right? You have armed actions to justify repressive measures and create climate of ungovernability. So it's like, they're killing us. We must now take out guns.
Right.
Until now we say, we're passive, we're non-violent, they're shooting us. But they're shooting us. Now let's get the guns out that we've kept, right? Oh,
yeah.
We have to, we're defending ourselves.
Right. It create mass hysteria so people would just...
Chaos on the streets,
right.
What are we going to do? You know, I'm not involved, but there's bullets on the streets, yeah? And then smear campaign among state forces to demoralize security forces. This whole like, oh, police, you're killing my people, you're killing my
right.
people. Again, I'm just saying, it's scripted in the book. You know, how to use it. I'm not condoning the police shooting at people. Oh my God, certainly not, you know. But that's kind of part of the script. And then again, then you have institutional fracture, the last stage, basically. Increased street action, occupation of institutions, when you have, you know, you take over an institution, a ministry or something, right, or schools, government institutions, etc. Eventually, you try and get to the, as they did in Ukraine, the forced, well, almost, right, almost, forced resignation of government, especially figurehead. Now, they signed a capitulation contract, but he didn't resign, he escaped. So we're still to see what happens in Ukraine. In Venezuela, I'm sorry, Ms. Opposition, I think you lost pretty much. I think we're done here. This coup, 2002, you lost. This one, you lost even more miserably. But in case of, finally, there's a last line in the code, right? It's like an algorithm. Any coders out there, right? So
right.
You can program this, right? In case of failure to overthrow government, rinse and repeat. Right? Escalate, that's not in the book. Yet.
Right.
Escalate stage 3, 4, and 5, you know? Start, reheat the streets further, you know? Reaction, institutional fracture. Interestingly enough, if you can't do it internally right away, when with the support, of course, the happy support of many institutions centered in Washington, Paris, London, Berlin, and other places that have supported these guys for a long time, you know. But if not, you call for help us.
Right.
Sanctions, maybe even military intervention.
Right.
Come bomb them for us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's been done before many a time. Let us remember 1973, the other 9/11. When America bombed Santiago de Chile, killing about 30,000 people at least, as part of precisely getting rid of an elected left government and putting instead of it a nasty right-wing junta. And I just want to say, you know, this looks awfully familiar, right? I mean, you see the script. I mean, so it's not perfect, but it's... You know, that's kind of what's going on with a lot of well-meaning, decent people caught in the middle. Let me be very clear about that.
Well, every single government that in history that we've overthrown, that's been basically the same script. I mean, it's undeniable. I mean, from the days of Chiquita Banana, who wreaked havoc in South America.
Right, the 40s, at least this model has been used more or less. I mean, I'm thinking maybe we're looking at an attempt to go into, and maybe Ukraine, parts of it at least, will be this colonization version 3.0, whatever, right? Where colonization version 1 was like the old, right, age of exploration.
Right.
Where you go, you conquer the country, you massacre, you take over, you take the resources, the people, whatever, yeah? 2, the post-colonial is where you don't, you support the local dictators. And the 3 is kind of a democratic regime. That does it to its people, you know,
anyway. In-house service.
So, dictators everywhere. And by the way, we're talking, shout out, if that's the appropriate term, you know, Libya.
Oh.
Libya is almost universally accepted by all the progressives and people critical of, we have an example of a humanitarian intervention that's not rotten to the core. Sorry. Very rotten to the core. Racist to the core. You know, Gaddafi wasn't great, certainly not as good as Chavez.
Right, oh, absolutely.
He was even, you know, in some ways bad, but he was certainly not even a contender to the top ranks of nasty dictators out there. And so there's that. Syria, again, a bit more complicated because Assad clearly was in one of the higher leagues of nasty dictators. But we're fanning the flames. We want them to kill each other. Blocking every peace opening possible. So yeah, it's a very ugly, ugly history, and that falls to the part I think podcast days, radio show days, we talked all about this kind of, there's the right, wrong and right ethical argument, and there's also the smart, stupid argument, right? You know, and ideally you're shooting for that ethical and smart, you know, and in some ways, you know, that's the goal. Now it seems like, you know, we are operating too often and almost all the time in the evil and stupid, which is the worst possible state.
Yeah, you know, and another thing that the media here hasn't really said is that Maduro won those elections pretty much fair and square. It's 10%. Yeah, 10%.
Yeah.
And on people's minds may not be a lot, but that's usually what happens here in the States.
Right. It wasn't like Chavez all these years, all the way since 98, in a landslide. Like, you know, 90%, you know?
Yeah, we don't even do landslides here.
No. And people are even questioning, like, Carter Foundation and different international institutions that have certified the Venezuelan election as one of the cleanest. A lot of these guys,
I'm sure the Heritage Foundation,
are talking about how, I can't believe how those Western academics say that it was, you know, we saw plenty of corruption and... First of all, we better shut up.
Yeah, as far as corruption, please. I think we wrote the book on that one.
Yeah, the big difference is it's legal here. Right?
Yeah, exactly. it's legal, and we've pretty much done it everywhere.
There's clear support, and you know, despite I'm hopeful that Venezuela is going back to stability though, because even Caprile, the guy who lost to Maduro and with did very well, really. I mean, historically well, you know. In the spring, in the presidential, he lost to Maduro pretty close, you know? So that was kind of a big success for him. That's the moderate guy, right? And in many ways, I read these street guys following the script I just read as just as much against him as against the Chavista regime.
Right, right.
To get rid of we don't want the moderate. We want a coup, we want to go back, grab power, good old days.
But they want to go back to the way it used to be, plain and simple.
He's genuine, possibly, you know, in the sense that he's a right-winger, he's a conservative, he believes in free market capitalism, and he's fighting for it in the politically.
I mean, it's the same argument for Cuba. I mean, we've been doing sanctions on Cuba for the longest time, and bottom line is, would they ever lift up the gates in Cuba, the first thing that's going to happen is all the rich people who abandoned Cuba are going to flock back to try to regain their land. I mean, there was a huge thing in the media, about 15 years ago, when they thought that Castro was almost dead.
Yeah,
where people were already organizing to go back to Cuba and get their money and their lands. And it's kind of like, well, okay, if you left, you didn't fight for it, for what was yours, then you're going to go back and take it off from other people. You're no different than...
Go back to the plantation whorehouse that
right.
it was under
exactly.
the same people that
exactly.
escaped quickly.
Right. And for you guys, it's not even a Republican, Democratic issue
nope.
because the Democrats were the ones using Cuba as a bordello, you know, for the longest time.
Note that
you
foreign
know.
Policy is one of the places where, yeah, that's a good point you raised, right? Foreign policy, Democrat, Republicans are
identical.
In some way, no, actually. No, Democrats are worse, especially now.
Exactly.
Because the, one of the beauties of the Obama administration is that it eviscerated the anti-war movement.
Mm-hmm.
That now can kind of, you know, the, some people still, you know, don't get me wrong, but actually a lot of the real anti-war movement that was mobilized against Bush are trying to, but the party is able to shut them down. Yeah, there's no difference on foreign policy. If anything, maybe upside down, maybe even worse, because the Republicans have a harder time to get away with it.
Right.
And that's an opportunity to be all bridge building to our friends in the right wing again, you know? That's the, you know, I disagree with the libertarians on most economic issues. I think Ron Paul and his son are wrong about everything
right,
to do
right.
with economics.
Wrong about a lot of things, but right on
but
some things.
Absolutely right on that, you know? And that is what they're hated for in their camp, you know, in their Republican camp. So that's definitely my, you know, I think we have some things that we can stay in common. But yeah, so that's a, it's an ugly story, but I think it's resolving there. Ukraine,
on the other hand, yeah,
could degenerate. First of all, much more violence, much more suffering. Secondly, the opposition is much more wide. It's
mm-hmm.
not rich kids only, you know. It's
but the changes are quick though, because from last Thursday all the way to now, now the public basically has taken over all the government buildings. That was
yeah.
one of the reports that I seen. And then, I think today, they actually stormed into the president's house and they found, it's typical of wealth and people who are just greedy, but they found jacuzzis, and they even had a live zoo. I kind of wonder if he's related to Michael Jackson or something. I mean, like,
so I wouldn't
house.
Be surprised if he inherited it from the previous
right.
president, who has been released from prison now and is coming back as the hero.
Right, right, and that's,
they're both
and that's just said
monstrously.
And that's just said you just don't know who's worse, because if you dig up the history of the former prime minister, and I can't pronounce her name to save my life, the one in the wheelchair, how's that? Because I'm
Lina
sure
Shenko, as opposed to Yanushenko,
right?
But I should probably
right.
look it up. I'm awful with names.
I mean, she was just hardcore, you know, ruthless and corrupt.
Yeah.
So you look at both sides and like, okay, so who are you gonna pick? The one with the less corruption or the one with the less dictatorship?
Yeah.
You know, so
but there's plenty of baggage there too. It's different baggage than Latin American baggage. But, you know, Ukraine has been one or the other part of the, you know, Russia, greater Russia for centuries.
Well, the outside influence is even harder.
The European Union and the United States, on the one hand, offering a deal that would benefit only the wealthy. There's the ethnic break there, in the sense that you do have the country is split between
mm-hmm.
the kind of really people who have been part of the Russia, our province of Russia, and that's their culture, they speak Russian. And people who are kind of Ukrainian nationalists, they have baggage because they fought on the wrong side of World War II.
Right.
Exactly. you know what? That's old baggage.
Which
in
I've
a
seen
sense.
Some comments from
yeah.
some Jews talking about.
Well,
the problem
they
hate it.
You know that I don't use the Jew card very often. I really don't. In fact, most of my Jews accuse me of not using it enough. I find the Jews see anti-Semitism a little bit too readily everywhere, but right now, a large chunk of the freedom fighters that have won,
mm-hmm.
You know, spraying Jew go home all
yeah,
over,
exactly.
all over
yeah.
Kiev, you know,
right.
the rabbi of Kiev has actually announced, literally, an emergency, get out of
right,
Kiev.
Kiev, right.
And yeah, these are some of the most virulent skinhead neo-Nazis in the world.
And of course, it's being used just like Hitler to basically take the eye off of the real core social issues.
Yeah,
you
sure.
know, just kind of split and divide through ethnicity.
Yeah.
You know,
because the core economics here is that the UN-US deal to come to the West, be part of Europe for a period of time, would have been... would have almost, you know, it's hard to argue anything but catastrophic for the vast majority, all but the very wealthy in Ukraine
right.
have benefited.
And of course, in talking about the wealthy, I mean, Obama's already talking about putting sanctions. on the Ukraine, and even on Russia if they need to.
Yeah.
I mean, that was actually said yesterday.
Wasn't it? I mean, that's punk. That's very punk for us to say. It's like the slogan that Malcolm McLaren, manager of the Sex Pistols and the rock and roll swindle, cash out of chaos.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly.
That's let's just say that it's certainly problematic. It's not obvious. I can understand westernized, you know, in the west of the Ukraine, not wanting to come under the boot of Vladimir Putin.
Right.
You know what? I get it. And, you know, and we're all scandalized by his law against gay propaganda, which is, you know, really disgusting.
You know,
it's important, but again, you know, I mean, are we worried, you know, that we have to look at also the big picture.
You know, usually, I learned this in psych class, usually when a person is so hardcore against some kind of norm, you know, like let's say the gay community, is because they're basically in the closet. So you might want to keep that in mind when it comes to Putin.
Say it to his face.
You know, I mean...
He is a very handsome man and very muscular,
very buff, and he does parade out there with his shirt off
and
all
stop
that.
Getting hot and bothered here.
I mean, that's the kind of scene I used to see at the gay pride parade in San Francisco,
right.
Men with their shirts off. So,
yeah.
I mean, Vladimir, hey.
Sadly, no. I think what's going on is like, hey, Americans should be quite familiar with that. He's pandering to it's a conservative country.
Right.
A religious country.
Mm-hmm.
One of the few things that, in some ways the socialists did better, is not encourage the whole, like, you know, old school religious beliefs, you know, believe anything you want. I'm quite rather open-minded, but, you know, I do believe in a secular
that's
society.
Changed. That's changed quite a bit in the last few years, because if you take Pussy Riot,
yeah,
you know, I mean, that's...
God, I see the clip, we should post that too. The clip they shot while they were being beaten up.
Yes, I see that.
Yeah,
but I mean, that's a clear view of how you know, Putin, you know, has changed that whole system, because before they wouldn't even think about it.
Yeah.
You know, but there you go.
Right. And I mean, Putin really doesn't deserve the excuse, but maybe, I mean, we can close by just also pointing out one thing that in the big context that we try to kind of throw all over the place. Kind of the intellectual equivalent of monkeys throwing their feces around, I guess, to some extent. There is, you know, you're not playing alone, right? So just like Fidel, did Fidel cause not perfect? Far from it. Was Chavez perfect? Far from it. And who is, yeah?
Right.
But these were experiments, generally for the better, for the majority of the people. Done in an environment that was hostile to them tremendously.
Right.
I mean, even maybe the communist revolution in Russia wouldn't have gone so bad so fast had they not correctly perceived that the rest of the world is ready to invade them right away. Ukraine was notably
right.
too.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of motivated, mobilized into it, like Russia. That's what Ukraine was. For that area. Anyway, but right, and same thing for Fidel, you know, maybe he wouldn't have had to tighten up on media and you know, on the border crossings and stuff like that if he didn't know that you know, the greatest, most powerful country in the world is 50 miles away from him,
right.
Hell-bent on destroying him.
Mm-hmm.
Same for Venezuela, you know, actually, you know, they created that core with
right.
the other countries. They wouldn't, as they say, the other countries that liberated from, you know, centralized regimes, Bolivia, Peru, Ecuador, not everybody, Argentina,
China.
Brazil are
mm-hmm.
different, but still are part of that family. They had the support of Chavez. Chavez came up against Colombia that was doing what it was told. It's saying, oh, you're sending your death squad? Well, my army is getting ready to meet with you, and we have the oil dollars to back it up. So I'm just, you know, saying that it's easy to be open and civilized and gentlemanly when you live in stability and peace, and you can negotiate
sure.
your difference, you know, in the United Nations or whatever, you know, and sit around the table and come to compromise. That's kind of what we're shooting for. But when you have death squads and, you know, and coups, you know,
But bottom line, that all goes down to the wayside, because bottom line is, and I'm sure you would agree with me, in world economics, what rules the world is the military, industrial complex. That's what's ruling right
Though
now.
Though I'm rooting now to change it into the military financial complex, because it's really, that's key actually. And I did host, and we'll talk again about it, I did post links on punkonomics.org. Right there, it should be written.
Yep.
Yeah. there's a wonderful article on Bill Moyers, written on Bill Moyers' site, and a little clip for interview, like 15 minutes for it. I mean, this notion of that open conspiracy, and at the heart of it is Wall Street. You know?
Right, of course.
Global Wall Street to some extent. It's not always happening on Wall Street and Manhattan Island, though. Still, yeah. And the military is have become their troops. You know, it's no longer fighting for whatever
right.
misguided or well-guided interest of the American people. So it's really a military financial complex. Yeah, it's the energy, there's oil industry, everything, but all of the industry is controlled by the financial interests. It's one of the things that happened recently. It's a catastrophe. Again, concentration of power. Free market people understand it just as well as Marxists.
Right.
You know, concentration of power is always bad.
And of course, and the way to enforce it is through the military, overthrowing countries, you know, and salt down for corporations.
Yeah.
Plain and simple. Yeah. I mean, anybody who thinks that it's just a government that put together, kind of like the evil empire in Star Wars, that's not the case.
They own the government.
It's the corporations. They're the ones manipulating the government. You know, and then when everything goes down the tubes, then they blame the government. You know, then they go away and come back and promote our concerts with U2, you know, or all that kind of stuff.
The feel-good mechanism.
Yeah,
that's the propaganda mechanism,
yeah.
Which it's also, like I said, that's on it all.
Yeah, the feel-good strategy. And everybody goes home and everybody's happy.
That's
except for the people getting shot or starving in the streets. Which, by the way, we have that here too, and quite
yeah.
a bit of it.
Increasingly. But you know what? Yeah. Now we're really finishing. I mean, in some sense, the American people, more than ever before, possibly, you know, hold the future in their hands. You know, because the power of America is overwhelming, but over America there are other powers.
Right. Exactly.
But the American people don't hold the power of America. You know? So that's really a very, very, very much the case, you know. And then solidarity across, you know,
right.
everywhere, you know. Try and put yourself in other people's shoes.
So in that note, I mean, I think
the first
episode of Punkonomics
right.
video.
And
go.
We'll cut different things and tell us what you liked, what you didn't like. And I don't know, maybe Jesse will edit this a little bit because I got to get back to writing those papers. And writing more blog posts and maybe making short ones and everything. Yeah, please, you know, let us know.
Yeah, give us a feedback, punkonomics.org.
I don't know exactly what I'm looking at, actually, because I'm always like, I'm looking at...
I know, we need to
Charles
put like
back,
a,
you know, and you're talking to my wife's back.
We need to put something on these cameras so we can... anyway, Punkonomics has always been lo-fi.
Lo-fi,
you know. So, tune in again, Punkonomics. We'll see you again soon.
Ciao.
Say bye-bye, Juliet. Baby.
Yeah, you know her allegiance now, eh? Definitely not you, Benny.
Oh, you've seen when she saw Jesse, she was like, before she saw him, she smelled him.
Uh-huh.
She was in a catatonic state almost, you know? Are you kidding me? How long did we go?
It's about an hour, right?
Yeah.